Hello everyone. Today I'll be talking about my work on post-quantum multi-party computation in constant rounds. And this is joint work with James Bartusek, Vipul Goel, Dakshita Khurana, and Julio Malavolta. And I would like to thank James for letting me use his slides. So let me start by giving some background. So we all know that security of our cryptographic schemes rely on the existence of computationally hard problems. For example, the RSA crypto system relies on the difficulty of factoring product of large primes. But with quantum computers, the situation is quite different because these quantum computers can represent information in terms of qubits and can exploit quantum mechanics such as superposition and entanglement to process information much faster than what classical computers can do. And indeed, some of you might have heard of Shor's quantum polynomial time factoring algorithm, which can be used to break the RSA crypto system. So with that, this initiates the study of post-quantum cryptography, where we want to design classical protocols. So protocols which can be run on classical computers, but are still secure even against quantum attacks. And this requires two ingredients. First, we need the existence of quantum hard problems, for example, lattice-based crypto. And the second ingredient that we need are new kind of security proofs. So what do I mean by these new security proofs? Most classical security proofs against malicious adversaries require a technique called rewinding. And this form of classical rewinding doesn't directly work in the quantum setting due to a well-known no cloning theorem, which states that given an arbitrary quantum state, you cannot make two copies of the same quantum state. And this is what this work will be about, how to create new kind of security proofs to realize general purpose multi-party computation against quantum adversaries in constant rounds. So let me give an overview of the known simulation techniques, both in the classical and quantum literature. So the first well-known technique is rewinding, as we might know about. And this was the first classical technique that was used to construct classical malicious verifier zero-knowledge proofs. There is an adaptation of this technique in the quantum setting by John Waters, but this requires polynomially many rounds. Then we have the non-black box simulation technique by Barak from 2001. However, even in this kind of simulation, the simulator has to clone the adversary state. So this kind of simulation is not quantum friendly. Then we have this recent paradigm called homomorphic trapdoor paradigm. And this was initiated in the work of Bitansi Khurana Panay from 2019, which is a non-black box simulation technique where you assume that the simulator knows the code of the adversary. And this was used to create constant round post-quantum zero knowledge proofs recently. And in this work, we extend the same kind of proof techniques to build general purpose multi-party computation in constant rounds, which crucially doesn't clone the adversary state in the simulation proof. So with that, let me give you some background on what the setting of MPC is. So we have a set of parties, each with their private inputs, and the goal is that they want to compute a function C on their private inputs by interacting with each other. The adversary might corrupt some subset of these parties indicated in red. And the security guarantee that we want is that the adversary should not learn anything about the private inputs of honest parties, apart from what it can deduce based on the output of the functionality. And the type of adversary that is generally considered in the literature is polynomial time adversary with static corruptions, arbitrary malicious behavior with dishonest majority. And there is a long line of works targeting this setting. But in our work, we want security against quantum polynomial time adversaries. There has been some work in literature on how to get security in the two-party setting. However, in the multi-party setting, this has been largely unexplored, especially in the constant round setting. So Our approach towards this problem is the following. So we observed that there are known classical protocols which are constant round MPC, assuming there is a trusted setup phase. And these works are based on garbled circuits and multi-key FH. And moreover, when you instantiate these classical secure protocols with post-quantum secure primitives such as SSPOT and NISIC, you get post-quantum secure MPC, but with a trusted setup. So what is this trusted setup? So the trusted setup is basically a common random string. And what one needs to do in the security proof is that the simulator of the common random string programs it, and thereafter the simulation is completely straight line. So we observe that the entire approach boils down to building a constant round, fully simulatable coin flipping protocol, which is secure against quantum adversaries. And once you have that, you can use that simulator to program the CRS, and thereafter the simulation is entirely straight line. So now with that, let me start by giving an overview of multi-party fully simulatable coin tossing. So we have a bunch of parties. And the functionality is that they all want to output some random string R. And a natural protocol template for realizing this functionality is that each party can just locally sample a uniformly random string RI and broadcast a commitment to it. Then in the second round, each party broadcasts the opening value of this commitment. In the third round, they prove that the opening value is consistent with their commitments, using a zero-knowledge proof. And if all the proofs verify, each party outputs the XOR of all the open values. So now, in the constant round multi-party setting, what we want is that the first phase where each party commits to its random value RI should be a multi-party constant round extractable commitment. Not just that, we also want that the third step should be a multi-party constant round zero knowledge proof. So now let me note that this task of creating multi-party constant round extractable commitments is the major challenge that we face in our work. And this is challenging in the quantum setting. So let me give a brief overview of what extractable commitments are. So these are just like regular commitments where there's a committer, a receiver, committer wants to commit to some message. And let's say C is the commitment string. So we have the usual hiding property that C shouldn't reveal anything about the message of the committer during the commitment phase. And binding that the committer C shouldn't be able to open his commitment to a different message in the opening phase. Along with that, we have this additional property called extractability, which demands that there exists an efficient extractor machine E, which can interact with the committer, malicious committer, during the commit phase and output the message that he's trying to commit to. Now, in the quantum setting, we have, as I mentioned, we have this no cloning barrier that we cannot clone the state of the adversary, and all classical extraction techniques rely on rewinding or some form of cloning. But we observe that there is this recent line of works which build non-cloning straight line extractors using non-black box simulation ideas. And the crucial tool that these works use is fully homomorphic encryption and compute and compare obfuscation. And so let me describe these tools, and I'll describe what their technique is, because our technique crucially extends on their technique to the multi-party setting. So let's start with what the fully homomorphic encryption in Gradient is. So we have a client and the server. So Alice is the client. He has some private input X that he is wanting to commit to, that he wants to compute upon. So client can generate a public secret key pair, encrypt his private input using the public key and send it to the server. The server can take the ciphertext and do a homomorphic evaluation on the ciphertext to produce an evaluated ciphertext C star and return it back to the client. The client can then locally decrypt its evaluated ciphertext, and the correctness property ensures that the output of the decryption is actually the evaluation of the function on the private info. So now let's look at what compute and compare obfuscation is. So this kind of obfuscation takes in a special kind of program called compute and compare program, which I've denoted by CC over here. And it has three parameters. So the first parameter is a function f, some hard-coded function f. The second parameter is some log value. And the third parameter is some message m. And the functionality of this program is that it takes in an input x, evaluates the function on this input x, and if the output is the log value, then it returns the message. Otherwise, it returns an error. So this is what a compute and compare program is. The obfuscator lets us obfuscate these special kind of programs into and convert them into an obfuscated program, which looks like complete garbage. And this obfuscated program has the same functionality as the original program, but it is computationally indistinguishable from a program which always returns error message. So now let me describe what the homomorphic trapdoor paradigm is that is used in this work to build a non-rewinding, no-cloning extraction technique. So we have a committer who is trying to commit to some message M and a receiver. So as a first step, the committer samples an FHE key pair, a trapdoor, and a log value. And then it computes an encryption of the trapdoor. Then it prepares this special compute and compare program where the hard-coded function is the decryption circuit of the FHE, and there is this log value that it sampled earlier, and the output is just the secret key of the FHE along with the message. So if you manage to input a value which decrypts to the log value, then you get the secret key and the message. This is what the compute and compare program will do. Now the committer obfuscates this program and calls and gets CC tilde, and then sends a triplet consisting of the public FHE public key, the encrypted trapdoor, and the obfuscated program to the receiver. In the second round, receiver tries to take a guess at what the trapdoor might be, which we'll call TT prime. And then the committer on receiving this guess checks whether the guess is correct. And if so, it returns the log value that it sampled earlier. Otherwise, it just returns bot. Now, it's clear that this commitment scheme is actually hiding, because the semantic security of the FHE scheme ensures that a malicious receiver cannot guess the trapdoor in the second round. And so, the lock value from the obfuscated program will be completely hidden from its view. And therefore, CC tilde will hide the message M. Now let me talk about how an extractor, which has access to the code of the adversary, which is the malicious committer, can still manage to extract the message M out of it. So as a first step, the extractor runs the first round of the malicious committer on some initial state ST, reaches some intermediate state ST prime, and manages to get a triplet out of the adversary. So this triplet consists of the FHE public key, the encrypted trapdoor, and the obfuscated program, just like before. Now, in the second round, the extractor has to take a guess at what the encrypted trapdoor is. But he cannot do so. Just like an honest committer cannot guess it in the real world, the extractor cannot guess it. But what it can do is guess the trapdoor under the hood of FHE. So in the second round, the extractor will execute this last step of the malicious committer under the hood of FHE, which means that it will run the eval function on this fourth step using the encrypted trapdoor as input. And what it manages to get is an encrypted third round message. And this third round message is indeed the log value, because under the hood of FHE, the guess was correct. So it gets encryption of the actual lock value along with an encryption of the final state of the adversary, which is ST double prime. Now, the extractor can use this encrypted log value, feed it into this obfuscated CC tilde program, and get out the secret key and the message. Because if you look at the obfuscate, the compute and compare program, evaluating the decryption circuit on this encrypted lock indeed gives you the lock value. So the output will be the secret key and the message. Now it has already got the message M. As a last step, the extractor uses the secret key to decrypt the encrypted final state in order to receive a plain text version of the final state of the adversary, and also outputs this final state along with the extracted message. Now, this homomorphic trapdoor paradigm has been useful to construct constant round post-quantum zero knowledge, thus improving upon the polynomial round quantum zero knowledge protocols of Waters and Unruh. And in this work, we basically explored whether this extraction technique can also be used in the multi-party setting, where we want to do multi-party coin flipping. And the main challenge in our work was basically how can we ensure that the extractor can extract simultaneously from multiple parallel committers. So an adversary which is corrupting multiple committers, how can the extractor manage to extract from all of them simultaneously? So let me motivate the problem a bit more. So let's try to run the same technique as before on two committers. So the adversary here is corrupting two committers in parallel. And let's say that extractor runs the same procedure as before, reaches an intermediate state ST prime, and manages to get now two triplets of public key encrypted trapdoor and obfuscated program. Now, it can try to take a guess at what these trapdoors is in the second round by doing the same trick as before and trying to evaluate the last step of the adversary under the hood of FHE. But the challenge is that it has individual encryptions of trapdoor. So these are separate encryptions of trapdoor under separate public keys. But the extractor has got only one chance of doing the evaluation. So it has to do a single evaluation of the adversary on both these inputs, the encrypted trapdoor 1, encrypted trapdoor 2, and get out the log values, encrypted log values. But what should be this evaluation upon? So in the last In the previous scheme, we saw that this was just the FHE evaluation, but now we have two inputs encrypted under different public keys. So a natural way to resolve this is to use multi-key FHE, which is like a generalized form of FHE in the multi-client setting. So you have multiple clients, each with their individual public secret key pairs and their private inputs. They can encrypt their inputs under their own public keys and send these ciphertexts to the server. The server can do a homomorphic evaluation on these ciphertexts under a joint public key and get out a evaluated ciphertext C star, which it can then send to clients. The clients can now locally run a partial decryption protocol on these ciphertexts, on the evaluated ciphertexts, to get out some output, and this output should be interpreted as a partial output. And the key property is that these partial decryption outputs are actually additive secret shares of the actual output of the function on the private inputs of all parties. So this is what is known as the spooky property in this multi-key FHE setting, and this is achieved by this work by Dodis et al. And so our main idea is that we can run this homomorphic evaluation step on the adversary under using multi-key FHE on the joint public key of both the committers. So, and then get out encrypted third round messages But the problem is not quite solved, because what we actually get is an encryption of the two log values and the final state under the joint public key. So this is still better than before, but not complete, because to take advantage of the obfuscated programs and get the actual message out, what we actually want is an encryption of the individual locks under the individual public keys, not joint public keys. And so what the extractor has is an encryption of the two lock values under joint public keys along with the obfuscated programs, and it needs to recover both the secret keys and both the messages. So our idea is that as a first step, what we can do is convert these multi-key ciphertexts under the joint public key into a nested form where the locks are first encrypted under PK2 and then under PK1. And we'll see later how this can be done. But for now, assume that this can be done efficiently. Once we have this, what we can do is take the second encryption. So we have lock 2 encrypted under PK2 and then under PK1. Take this and evaluate CC2 tilde on this input homomorphically under the hood of public key 1. So what we are indeed doing is we are feeding CC2 an encrypted lock, a nested encrypted lock 2 value under the hood of public key 1. And what we will get as output is the secret key 2, but because we did a homomorphic evaluation, this will also be under the hood of public key 1. But now what we can do is take this secret key 2, which is encrypted under PK1, and peel off the inner layer of encryption from this first nested ciphertext. So what we can do is take the nested encryption of lock 1 and the secret key 2, which is encrypted in a PK1, and peel off the inner layer by evaluating the decryption circuit of FHE2 under the hood of FHE1. Now what we get is an encryption of lock 1 under PK1, which can directly be evaluated on CC tilde 1 program to get out the actual secret key 1 and the actual message 1. And this can be done symmetrically to extract secret key 2 and message 2 as well. So now let me complete by mentioning how we can convert from this joint public key encryption to a nested encryption. So we do this by relying on the AFS spooky property of the multi-key FHE. So in this kind of FHE, an evaluated ciphertext, so imagine an encryption of lock 1 under joint public key PK1, PK2, is of the following form. So we have a pair, each encrypted individually under PK1 and PK2, and the Z1 and Z2 are actually secret shares, additive secret shares of the actual log value. So this is the spooky additive function sharing property. So once we have this property, we can use it to convert the joint encryption into a nested encryption in the following way. So we take the first half of the pair. So first share and encrypted share, and do two layers of homomorphic evaluation. So we first go under PK1 and then go under PK2 and XOR Z1 into Z2. And what we get as output is, because Z1 XOR Z2 is lock 1, we get lock 1 encrypted under PK2 and then under PK1 because we went two layers down. As a side note, I would like to mention that since our adversary is quantum, so we need a multi-key FHE scheme which supports evaluation of quantum circuits and not just classical circuits. And we do this by combining single key FHE schemes which support quantum circuits and multi key FHE schemes which support classical circuits. We combine these two techniques in order to construct multi key FHE schemes supporting evaluation of quantum circuits. And I would not go into the details. You are encouraged to look into the paper for this. So now this completes our construction of constant round extractable commitments in constant rounds against quantum adversaries. And we note that this directly gives us constant round zero knowledge proofs as well in the multi-party setting by relying on existing techniques in the literature. So now our coin flipping template is almost complete. So we replace the first round with a parallel extractable commitment and the third round with a parallel zero knowledge proof. However, there is a slight malleability issue. So note that an adversary which is receiving a parallel extractable commitment from an honest player to some value R1 can create a parallel extractable commitment to some value R2 in such a way that R2 has some dependence on R1. For example, R2 can just be R1 plus 1. And this is bad because this can bias the outcome of the protocol. So the final outcome R might not be uniformly random, and we need to ensure that that is the case in order for the security proof to go through. So to do that, we rely on post-quantum constant round non-malleable commitments, which is also something that we construct in this paper. So we do that by relying on erasure channel-based constant round non-malleable commitments. So these are classical commitments from this work by Khurana and Sahai. And the well-known DAG amplification technique from Dolev to Ognov. We combine these two techniques to construct post-quantum constant round non-malleable commitments in our paper. So with that, our final coin flipping protocol looks like before, but we have an additional step in the beginning where each party sends a non-malleable commitment to the value Ri and the randomness that they plan to use in the parallel extractable commitment. So they send a non-malleable commitment to both these things, and this sort of ties the extractable commitment to the non-malleable commitment, this Ri and Si, which helps a security proof to go through. So with that, our final result is that there exists a constant round MPC protocol in the plain model, which is secure against quantum polynomial time adversaries, assuming an LWE-based circular security assumption, which is what we use in order to construct this quantum multi-key FHE with spooky property. And this in turn lets us create constant round parallel extractable commitments, which is quantum secure, and constant round parallel zero knowledge proofs, which is also quantum secure. And the second assumption that we rely on is a mildly super polynomial hardness of LWE, by which we mean that there exists some fixed constant C, such that no QPT adversary has advantage better than lambda raised to minus iterated log of lambda C times in distinguishing LWE samples from uniform. And we use this assumption in order to build post-quantum constant round non-malleable commitments. And with that, I conclude my talk. Thanks for listening.